This conference will now be recorded.
So yesterday we discussed about the agent, standard agent and advanced agent like that, and how exactly so we can choose the standard agent. And so how the statuses will be changed and how exactly we can trace the agent, so that we have discussed. Okay. So today we will be having something called job scheduler and queue processor. Okay, this job scheduler and queue processor are replacement of the standard and advanced agent. Okay, so instead of the standard agent, they will be using the queue processor. We will be using the queue processor. Okay, for the advanced agents, so we will be using the job scheduler. Okay, so and for the agents, for the standard agent, so it is going to be taking the access group, okay, from the work object, who created it. Okay, so if the user one has created one work object and queue to the standard agent, then the standard agent will be taking the access group from the user one itself. Okay, so if user three performs any work object and queues to the standard agent, then the standard agent will be taking the access group from the user three and then processing the work object. But where for the advanced agent, so at the agent level, we will be specifying the access group from that it is going to be processing. Okay, but it is somewhat little different for the job scheduler and queue processor. So how exactly you can create the job scheduler and queue processor? So in general, agents are under the category of the sysadmin. Okay, in the same way. Job scheduler and queue processor are also part of the sysadmin category. Okay, so if you want to create any job scheduler or queue processor, you just select this. Give you any name for that. So I'm giving job scheduler. Okay. Like this. So this is the job scheduler rule, okay, under which again you will be having, okay, so whether you want to run on all associated nodes or any one associated node. Okay, so if you would like to run on all nodes, you can select all association nodes, otherwise only one associated node. So if you select one associated node, then it will be asking that, okay, multiple times a day, how many times you want to run it. Okay, in a day. So like a daily, weekly, monthly, yearly. So in the same way, how we will be applying for the agents. So for the job scheduler also, we can do the same thing. Okay, so whether you want it daily or weekly or monthly or yearly, otherwise multiple times a day. Okay, after every, in case you will be applying for 30 seconds, right? In the same way, in case if you want to do it also, you can select that for every 30 seconds. Otherwise, if you select that, okay, daily, again you can apply on which days you wanted to apply, all those things like that. See, every day, otherwise every weekday. Okay, so likewise you can apply these things as well. So everything is similar only, but the only thing is internally how it is going to be working will be different from the Pega side. So the context, and after that, this is the more important thing. Okay, so as I said, for the advance the agent, we'll be taking the access group from the agent only, right? Okay, so now for the job scheduler, okay, so here the context it is having something called specify access group. So in case if you specify the access group, it will be taking from here. Okay, it will be taking from here. Otherwise, so this is one of the new concept, okay, in the job scheduler, that is use system runtime context. Okay, use system runtime context. Okay, in case if you select this use system runtime context, okay, there is some separate rule is there, system runtime context. From that rule, it is going to be taking the respective application, and from that application, it is going to be processing the work object. So that means in case if you are having multiple applications in your okay server, okay, so you may be scheduling many number of the agents for processing. So then the work object, okay, which it is kept for processing, okay, under the job scheduler, okay, under the queue which it is kept for processing, okay, from that application only it is taking, not from the operator level, okay, not from the operator level, it will take from the application. So that application will be taken from the system runtime context. Okay, so that system runtime context will be under this is like what is the runtime context. So it's called runtime context will be there. Yeah, system general, system runtime context. Then why it is not showing in the system? Yeah. No problem, leave it. So here you will be having system runtime context. So under the system runtime context, here you can select the applications which are available in your server. Okay, now you may be creating the work objects under the ICICI CT, ICICI TermMap, ICICI App, otherwise Pega rules. Okay, whichever the work object you create when you create, okay, when you create, then it will be taking from the system runtime context and it will be fetching the application that to which it belongs. Okay, so you need not specifying anything here, but you must specify that application under the system runtime context. Okay, you must specify under the system runtime context. Okay, if you specify your application under the system runtime context, then only okay, your work object will be picked automatically that respective application which belongs to that work object, and then it will be processing. So this application anyway will be having that. Okay, this application anyway will be having the required rule sets and everything, right? So based on that required rule set, it is going to be working accordingly. Okay, so that is the main difference. Okay, for the job scheduler. Okay, so this is one of the new concept included system runtime context. Okay, otherwise if you want to go with the older way also, okay, you can select specify access group, and again you can select the access group, okay, on which you would like to process this. But what it will be happening, it will be working only for the one application, ICICI app administrators. But instead of, if you don't want to take care of all these things like that, okay, any application okay, it may be having, okay, then you can go to the system runtime context, and again you can specify the applications, all the applications, then it will be taking internally automatically. Okay, and later the class on which the processing need to be done. Okay, so that means the functionality, okay, in which we have implemented the application processing, work object processing. Okay, so in the activity we'll be performing, right? So that it will be taken. Okay, so in case if you want to update the work object agent through, then you can select that. So now we can stop the agent and again we can perform it. And so long here one alerts also you can schedule it. Long running job scheduler threshold. Okay, so that means we can apply the long running job scheduler threshold. That means how long one job scheduler can run for processing the work object. Okay, so 10,000 milliseconds by default it has given. In case if you want, you can reduce it. Okay, so if that threshold is crossed, then it is going to be alert to the user. Okay, it is going to be sending the alerts to the user. So this is the job scheduler. And in the same way, okay, in the same way, we have something called queue processor. Create sysadmin. So the job scheduler is like a, this one, advanced agent. This queue processor is like a standard agent. Okay, so as I stated with node types, I hope you remember. We used to select that, okay, on which group of nodes we would like to run this. So like ADM, background, batch, bits, so all these things will be there. Okay, so whichever you want, you can select it. And when to process, whether you want to start the processing right after creating the work object, otherwise you want to delay it sometime. So in case if you delay it sometime, then okay, you will be delaying for some time, and then from that time onwards, it will be started executing it. And number of threads per node. So how many number of the threads you can create? Okay, that means if it is having 10 threads, okay, it can process 10 work objects at a time. Okay, it can process 10 work objects at a time. Okay, in case if you give one, only one markup, it will be processed at a time. Okay, so like that you can give, and after that the processing activity, so like class and again activity on which it belongs, so everything is same, and the maximum attempts how many you can give. Okay, so how many times you want to retry in case if the markup the processing fails. So if you give three, so three times it will be trying to process, and after that it will be stop trying to process again. And initial delay, so initial delay, how much time? Initially 1 minute it has to be delayed, and the delay factor. Okay, so these are not like, okay, delay factor, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes, if you want you can give it. So what is this delay factor? Okay, what is this delay factor? Okay, so let's take one example. So in case if the work object failed, how many times I want to retry? Three times I want to retry. Okay, so three times means first it will be start processing the work object. So due to some issue, some logging or else some issue. Okay, so W work object one is there. Okay, work object one. This is processing started at 9 a.m. Okay, so at that time it's failed. When it is processing, it's failed. Okay, now what it will do? Initial delay 1 minute. Okay, default value is 1 minute, and then delay factor is 5 minutes. So what it will do? So totally how many times we want to retry? So total 3 times. In that, one is over. Okay, one attempt over, one attempt failed. Now again it will take that W1. Okay, at what time? At what time? Initial delay 1 and a delay factor 5 minutes. So totally 9, 6. Okay, 9, 6 a.m. Okay, so it will try it in case if it is failed again. Okay, so second attempt also failed. Next it will go for the third attempt. So third attempt will be what? Delay factor. This is factor in case if you see it. Okay, it will be multiplied. The factor is used to calculate the period between the next retry attempt by multiplying the previous delay, by multiplying the previous delay value by the factor. With the default initial delay value of 1 minute and the delay factor of 2, the delay sequence is 1 minute, 2 minutes, 4 minutes, 8 minutes. Okay, so it is going to be multiplying it. Okay, 2 2 4. Okay, 2 4 8, like that. So here now we have given 5 minutes, we have given the delay factor. Okay, so next to W2, at what price it will be? So 9, after 9, now this time what will be the minutes?
8 minutes, I guess.
No.
10 minutes.
No.
9, 12.
No. 9:30 a.m. Why it is 9:30 a.m.? Carefully, the default initial delay value of 1 minute and the delay factor is 2, the delay sequence is 1 minute, 2 minutes, 4 minutes, 8 minutes. Okay, so it is multiplying, it is multiplying 4 into 2, 8, like that. Okay, so first 2 minutes. Okay, in case if you give here first 2 minutes, okay, 2 into 1. Okay, and later 2 into 2, and then 2 into 4, 2 into 2, 4, already it's decay. So 2 into 4. So likewise, so first time in case if you give, it's having 0. So 9 into 0, sorry, 5 into 0, maybe it will be 5, 9, 5. And after 9, 5, what it will be happening? Again, it will be multiplied with 5 minutes. Okay, so 5 minutes means 5 into 5, 25.
Sir, this one a bit confusing, sir.
Very simple, Jagdish. So when it is failed, how much time you want to give the gap for the next processing?
So at the first attempt, it is at 9 o'clock, 9:00.
Exactly.
So second attempt with initial delay should be 9:01, but we need to add 5 minutes also because of delay factor, which
yeah,
is nine.
Yeah, it is going to be multiplying with the delay. Okay, so 5 into 1, how much? 5 minutes.
Yeah, 5 into 1. So 5, 1 plus 5, 6.
Not plus, multiplication. This factor means multiplication, not addition.
Okay, 9:05 a.m. 5 into 1. That is delay factor into initial delay.
Yeah, exactly. 9:05. Okay.
Next in the next attempt. Initial delay, what will be the value, sir? Initial delay for the third attempt, initial delay and delay factors value.
Initial delay will be always 1 only.
Okay.
Once if it is multiplied with this 5 into 1, now forget about the initial delay. Okay, now you have the 5 in it.
5 delay factor.
Yeah, 5 delay. So now 5 into 5.
So the last delay factor into current delay factor, the last time into current value.
Exactly.
5, 5, 5, 5, 25.
Now 25 into 5. It will take 9:25. 9, forget about it. 25 into 5. So 25 into 5 means how much?
1 hour.
1 hour.
2 hours, 5 minutes.
Yeah. So
11 hours, 11.5.
11.5, exactly. Like that, it will be there. So, likewise, it will be having 3 attempts or 5 attempts. How many you give? It is going to be multiplying. So, that means it is increasing the gap for each and every attempt. Okay, why? Because the server may be not responding. So, if you try immediately, what is the use? There would not be any use. So, we may not be able to restart the server also. Okay, sometimes for restarting the server, it may take 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Otherwise, in the production, it may take sometimes, okay, even 15 minutes or 20 minutes also. Okay, so that is the reason why we are going to be increasing this factor, delay factor. Got it, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and then alerts configuration. Long running queue processor threshold, same as for the job scheduler, in the same way for this also, alerts configuration. So it is going to be giving the alerts. Okay, long running job scheduler threshold here, long running queue processor threshold. Okay, long running queue processor threshold. That's it. So, this is the main difference between the job scheduler and queue processor. Okay, instead of the agents, we'll be using this one. Okay, and the tracing and everything will be as usual. So here queue processor and job schedulers are the jobs. Okay, agents, we have already seen it. Okay, so jobs are the job schedulers and queue processors, they have given directly queue processor. So you can select anything here also. Okay, and directly you can select here, otherwise you can select here also. Okay, so there are that queue processors and jobs. So these are other job schedulers which are already available. Even for the service level agreements also now, they are using the PA process SLA. Okay, so you can directly start and stop it here. Okay, so you can filter like disabled or running, whatever you want to see, you can filter it. See here also, all queue processors are run resolved against the context specified in the system runtime context. See here. I hope you remember we have seen that system and time contest there also. Okay. Okay, in case if it is a jobs, earlier also we opened the jobs only. These are the queue processes. Yeah. The jobs like this. But the jobs, if you want, you can trace it from the job scheduler. Trace option will be like here, we can select it, and then whichever the agent kind of the job which it is running, so we can trace it. Comparatively, the agent's queue processors are little easy to implement and even for tracing also. Maybe this something. This is just a tracer. So it will open, and as usual, we can see the tracer events. So in case if you want to trace on specific node, you can select the trace here also. Okay, so this is about the job scheduler and queue processors. Next one is like dynamic system settings.
But in the job scheduler, the first tab. So here, the first two options, associated with node types and run on. So associated with node types, we can select more than one.
Yeah, exactly. It will list out all nodes if you are having multiple nodes, right? So it will list out, and then you can select multiple nodes.
Then in this runs on all associated nodes and any one associated node. So does that mean it will randomly run on any one associated node when we select the second option?
Yes, exactly. So at a time if it processes, right, again there is a possibility of locking issues and transaction management issues like that. So it is going to be take care of it. So any one associated node, it will take it.
Or else if we choose the first option, it will run on all the nodes.
Yeah, so but mainly for that, I told you, right, for some of the issues like, okay, if you want to send the email, okay, then you should not select this one.
We should select the second one.
Second one, exactly.
Are there any scenarios like we need to choose first one and the second one? Like in which scenario we need to opt for first one and second one?
Yeah, Jagadish. So in case if you want to send the email notification, okay, so if it is running on multiple nodes, what it will be happening, if it is running the server on 10 nodes, it will send the 10 emails for the same one, for same user, okay, for the same purpose, it will send the 10 emails. Okay, but one email, right? So why you want 10 emails? Okay.
Yes.
So in case we will be selecting any one associated node is enough. Okay, all associated nodes when we will be selecting means, okay, for example, okay, so all associated nodes, if you want to, there are thousands of work objects are there. So 1,000 work objects, if you want to process it, okay, then you can select all associated nodes. But then it will pick up only one work object by one node. Okay, second work object by second node. Okay, third work object by third node. So like that, it will begin processing. So that, so the processing will be faster.
Okay.
Okay, Yeah, same like standard and advanced agent, how exactly we discussed here also, we can apply the same thing. Okay. Fine. And the next one, so dynamic system settings. So what is the purpose of the dynamic system settings? So dynamic system setting rules are like data instances. Okay, they are the data instances. So what is the main purpose of the data instances, which we discussed many times comparatively with the rule instances? Rule instance is specific to the rule set and version. So if it is specific to rule set and version, it will be logged and we cannot update in the higher environments. Okay, if it is logged. So that is the reason why. So dynamic system settings means it is not specific to the rule set version. It is only specific to the rule set. Okay, so those cannot be logged. So even in the higher environments, you can update it easily. Okay, but maybe not by everyone in the organization, but mainly few people like that. Okay, so sometimes, if you see these services mainly, our integration services. View, okay, integration connectors, and then okay, we have something called ConnectSOAP, right? We created ConnectSOAP rule.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so here we created two ConnectSOAP rules. Okay, for the ConnectSOAP rule, okay, in general, to connect to the connect service, sorry, service SOAP, okay, to connect to the service SOAP through this ConnectSOAP, what we have done, we have given the endpoint URLs. Okay, service endpoint URL we have given. Okay, in the development environment, this endpoint URL is this one, but in the SA environment or else in the UAT or else in the QA or else in the production, will it be same endpoint URL? No, it will be different server. Okay, different endpoint URL will be there for each and every environment for the services. Okay, but here this is already checked in. Okay, this is already checked in. Okay, so you cannot check out it. Okay, as this rule set is already logged. Okay, so in which rule set we have created? Okay, here we have created in custint 01001. So you cannot check out and you cannot check in it right away. If it is locked, I think it is not logged, but in case if you log it, then you cannot check in it, right? Now this custint is in the checked out in the unlocked version. Okay, so if you lock it, okay, can we do this checkout?
No.
No, right? So in that case, how exactly you can modify this endpoint URL so that it will be connected to the right server? So that is the reason why Vega, what it has given, instead of using this, instead of hard coding the endpoint URLs here, okay, we can use the dynamic system settings. Okay, once if you create the dynamic system settings, okay, those dynamics, through that dynamic system settings, you can refer it here. Okay, so so how exactly we can create the dynamic system setting? This is like some of the constant rules kind of the things, okay, which will not be changed frequently and will be. Okay, so these are some of the dynamic system settings rules you see here. Okay, warning rule set, setting purpose, and then the value. Okay, warning rule set and setting purpose and value. Okay, so Cosmos host URL, they have given something called HTTP localhost 3000. In the same way, we can create our own also. Okay, so for this, okay, for this custom int, okay, we can create one DSS rule and we can refer it over there. So how exactly we can create this DSS rule? So right click on it and then create it. Okay, short description, anything you can give, like, so I'll be giving custom details, okay, endpoint URL and warning rule set. So what is the warning rule set means? Where exactly you would like to use that custom int you have to. Okay, setting purpose also you can give as the short description, or you can give different one. Then create and open. Okay, so now this endpoint URL is specified over there. Save it. See, as this is the data instance, it is only mapped to the rule set. Okay, there is no rule set version. Okay, there is no rule set version. So that is the reason why what happens, you know, when you move this rule to the higher environments, okay, like SIT, they will be changing the endpoint URL here. Okay, and in the UAT, they will be changing the endpoint URL here. In the production, they will be changing the endpoint URL here. Okay, they can log it into the environment and they can update it. Okay, but so here, it is already in the logged like that. So they need not update it here. So once if you update it over there, that will be updated here. So why? Because it's like some property we created, that property we'll be referring here. Okay, it's like a property we'll be referring here. So in the property, if you change the value, automatically wherever you refer that property, that will be referring to the same value. Okay, so how exactly you can refer this dynamic system setting rule means there is one function called get data system settings. Okay, get data system settings. So there is one function is there. In case if you are not aware of that function exactly, then what you can do? There any activity? Let's create one activity always. just for seeing the function signature, function parameters. Yeah, get data system setting. Okay, so this get data system setting is taking two parameters. First one is the owning rule set, and the second one is the setting value. Okay, so just you can give that, and then it will be taking it. Owning rule set what? TNT. And then owning purpose what? Okay, yeah, fine, there are no issues. So like with this, you can refer over there. We saved it, right? Yeah. So even if you see here, it can have our version. It's created our setting. Yeah, custom int. Okay, setting purpose, custom details in the parent URL, and then the value is our in the parent URL to which you wanted to connect it. Okay, now that custom details you can refer here. Okay, so like that, so you can refer this function, and then okay, you can update it accordingly. So not only here, even anywhere also, okay, even anywhere also in the activity, or else anywhere if you want to refer those values, then you can refer it.
Sir, at the rate is not required, sir. At the rate of get data system, only get data system setting.
Yeah, at this mandate. So sometimes there will be some constant values. Okay, so as I said, in the banks, the minimum balance should be 10,000, right? Even for those things also, at that time, what you can do, you can create the DSS value, and that DSS you can be referred over here. Okay, so from the next time onwards, what it will be happening? So next time onwards, what it will be happening? So
it will be the value from DSS.
Yeah, exactly. So in the DSS, simply you can update the value from 5,000 to 10,000, 10,000 to 20,000, whatever it is. Okay, so if you update over there, so wherever you refer that, okay, minimum balance property, so that will be taken from there. So mostly, you should not hard code the values for the property sets. Okay, you should not hard code. Okay, either you have to take from the user interface, otherwise you have to take from the DSS values. That is the common way of implementing it. This one being checked out. it will take automatically there. I have copied from there, so it did not take it. Let me take a look at it also. Okay. But there are still various ways are there to refer this service endpoint URL. But this is the general way of referring the service endpoint in the organization. So the way how they will be using, we can go on. But they will be referring through the okay, so dynamically passing this endpoint URL. They will never hard code the endpoint URLs. Why? Because as I said, okay, it will have the values from the higher environments. Okay, Jarvish. So this is about the DSS. And the next one I will talk about that navigation rules. So what are the navigation rules? Okay, what are the navigation rules? Okay, means here on click of the action, okay, we are getting one menu. Okay, so how exactly you are getting this menu means this is the navigation rule they have created. Okay, in the same way for the save also, we are getting one more menu here and small two options. Okay, so and here you are for view XML, get help, create. Okay, these are separated by lines, right? So after the refresh, one line is there. View reference, view siblings, view versions. Okay, these three belongs to one. And then one more line is there. And then view XML is there. Okay, after that one more line is there. So they are separating like that, okay, some categories into that. And after that, here if you see view versions, you are having one more submenu. Okay, so submenu, how you will be getting? Again, you have to create one more navigation rule and make it as a submenu. So how exactly you can do all these things means, okay, navigation rules are under the category of user interface. Okay, so create user interface and then navigation. Okay, so give the name like something. Just for example, I'm taking customer operations like this. Okay. So this is the navigation rule which it is creating. So under this editor, mainly, so the label, type, and actions. Okay, so the label what you want to give. For example, like here, view XML is the label, and then type. So what kind of the action you wanted to perform, and then action. So what exactly you want to do, whether you want to display the new pop-up window. You see here, if you select view XML, what it is happening? It is opening one pop-up window and it is displaying the values. Okay, so this is the one model window kind of thing. This is the one model window. So all these things we can apply here. So like here, first add above. Right now we don't have anything. So whether you select add above, add below, whatever you said, it doesn't matter. But once after you have at least one item here. Okay, now you see it has added one. Click on entry to edit. Okay, we have selected this and then here the type. Okay, so the type is whether you want to display it as an item, otherwise you want to display it as a item list or reference, custom, separator, selected item. In that most important things are item, okay, reference, and then separator only. Okay, others are not much important. So what do you mean by item? Right now, unclick of the action. Okay, you are getting it, right? So this is one item. UXML is one item. Get help is one item. Okay, create is one item. Okay, so reference means what? Reference means if you want to have some other navigation tool, then you can go for the reference. Okay, when exactly we will be going for that? So as I said, in case if you are having submenu kind of the things here, so view versions, then we will be selecting the reference. Reference will be referring another navigation tool, so by which we will be getting the submenu over there. Okay, and then this separator means, so this is just like a dots which it will be coming. Okay, so now first I will be creating like, one item. Okay, so what is the label you want to give? Add customer. In case if you want to give some tooltip also, you can give. Okay, so if you want images, all these things are you can apply. And so after that, the main thing is like actions. And click of the add customer. What exactly you want to do it? Okay, what exactly you want to do? The functionality. Okay, so as here I have shown you, UXML is showing on the one of the screen. So the screen how exactly can display means through the add an action. Okay, under the add an action. Okay, here. You can select local action. Okay, local action. So what is the local action in case if you want to display? So in case if you want to display customer search flow action, you can select that. And then where exactly you want to display? On model window, otherwise on overlay, and then replace current. Okay, presently this view XML is like a model window only, so it is like a opening on pop up window. Okay, opening one pop-up window. Okay. So in case if you want to display model window, otherwise overlay. Okay, overlay means it will be like a one mirror kind of the screen. Okay, so you can see the background, the location which it is already referring to that. Okay, and then even replace the current. So if you want to replace the current, it will not display. So here, if you see customer details, is replaced with this new one. Okay, so this test activity, okay, is replaced with the customer details. That means it will be replaced. So the other one will not be displayed it. Okay, other one will not be displayed it. So like that. Okay, so how exactly you want to display that window? You can select it here. Now, if you want to add below, now as you already have one, so it will be added in the below like this. So if you have n number of the flow actions for all of them, then you can display it accordingly. Add action. Okay, local action. Just to select branch details kind of thing. Okay. Okay. In case if you want to add the child node also, you can add it. So if you want to add the child node, you need to select to which you want to add the child node. Select it and then like this, you see here. Now it is adding the child node, like submenu. Okay, so here, again, whether you want to add item or else something else like that, reference, also you can select it. Any other navigation tool in case if you want to select it. For example, I have just created customer operations one navigation rule. Okay, so in general, we will be having the flows, right? Here we have something called customer details. We will be updating this one just to see the functionality of this navigation. Just for testing purpose. Okay, so this navigation rule either you can select from the button. In general, the buttons are there. But even if you want, you can add a menu control or else link also. From that also, even you can refer them. Okay, this is the layout it is. So on click of the button in the properties, okay, here customer details menu like that. I'm just giving the label this one, and then in the actions you need to specify it. Add an event on click of the button. Okay, add an action. So I want to add the menu. So here you need to select the menu. Customer operations, which have created the navigation room. Okay, so format you can apply the default one, standard. Yeah, customer details menu is there. You see. So you got the menu over there. So add customer, save customer details. Okay. And then delete customer. So we have created, click on entry to edit. So we have created the sub menu, right? So reference. So that is the reason you got it. But we did not add it any sub navigation rule over there. Yeah. See, for that delayed customer, okay, we did not refer anyone. So that is the reason why it is not created. So in case if you create one more navigation rule here, then that will be displayed over there. Okay, I'm not adding any functionality for that. But in case if you add any functionality through the actions, then you will be getting it. So mainly after creating the navigation rule, okay, whether for the button or else somewhere if you want to refer what exactly you need to do for the button, you need to apply the menu control. Okay, under the actions, you need to apply the menu control. Okay, so under the menu, the navigation rule which you want to display, you need to select it. So that is very simple like that. So in case after the add customer, in case if you want to add a pillow, and here if you want to add separator, see, you got the separator over there. Just one line, it will be coming automatically. So this is about the navigation rule, Jagdish.
Okay, sir.
Right. So tomorrow we will see the case management as well. Sorry. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Okay then.
Bye, okay, sir. Bye. Okay.